Hi, Donna Clarinets. Welcome back for week three. Hopefully things have been going well for you. I've already assembled kind of what I call my baby clarinet, which is my mouthpiece, my ligature, my reed, the barrel, and the upper joint. Remember, that's the one that has these keys that stick out. We always want to be careful with them. And I'm going to turn it around so that you can see my reed up close. It's neither too high or too low, but just a tiny little fingernail sliver of the top of the mouthpiece. I'm seeing a little rail of black showing at the top. That is about the perfect place to have my reed. If the reed is too high, remember that you're going to feel like you're blowing really hard. And if the reed is too low, you'll also feel like you're blowing very, very hard. And you may get sort of an air rush sound instead of a good clear tone, like a kind of sound to your quality. So I'd like you to take your lesson book, your Gold Essential Elements book, and turn to page 4, and this is where we had left off. And so these open notes that have no stem on them, we're going to play as whole notes. So we're going to give them 4 beats, and then in the where it says rest, we're going to give them 4 beats of rest. So you've already done this, but let's do it as a warm-up today. So I'm going to use my right hand lightly on my barrel just to steady my instrument. I don't want to be down too far close to my body, and I don't want to be too far out because I'll get a poor sound that way. It's about a 30 degree angle, and it's going to look like this. So let's start line number 1 as a warm-up. We have an open G, second line on the staff. Remember, we're always counting from the bottom up. And a G is no tone holes closed, so open. 1, 2, play with me, breathe. Silence, 2, 3, 4. Silence, 2, 3, 4. Good, okay. So now we're gonna go to line number 2. And this is also G's, also the second line up on the staff. But these are quarter notes, so each one is going to get 1 pulse or 1 beat. Now, a pulse can be fast, a pulse can be slow. It's whatever you decide or whatever a conductor decides will be the speed of a piece. So I could play this first measure at number 2, or I could play it. And depending on the speed that I'm going, those are all correct, as long as I'm giving them whatever is a pulse. So think of a pulse as how you would nod your head or you might tap your foot as you're listening to music. So we're going to take it kind of in the middle. So let's play line 2 together. We're going to be playing 4 G's that each get 1 beat, and then 4 beats of silence. And those of you that are really smart, catch on really quickly, you might say, well, I know what a whole rest is. Could they have done it different? And the answer is yes. And we will get to that soon. But for right now, we're going to just take those little lightning bolt rests one at a time. So here we go. Let's play together line 2, count and play on open G. 1, 2, play with me, breathe. Right down to number 3, a new note, and this is F. And we need to pay attention to the fact that the head of the note is slid down now to the very bottom space of the staff. And so the spaces spell face. It's a great way to remember them. F, A, C, E are the 4 spaces that you see within our staff. And remember, I told you last week that a staff is a graph, and it's how we talk to each other as musicians. So here is number 3, and we're going to play F. And if you look at your fingering chart, F is blackened in, and you're going to close your thumb hole. Remember that you're going to close it with your thumb at a slight angle, okay? And you want to use the meatier part of your thumb so that the tone hole seals up all the way. Otherwise, it's going to squawk back at you. Not too much mouthpiece, not too little mouthpiece, but about 1/3. And here's my teeth going on top. 1, 2, play with me, breathe. Rest. 2, 3, 4. Rest. 2, 3, 4. Awesome. Roll right down to line number 4. 2's a team. So in this one, we needed to be able to tell the difference between the F on the space and the G on the second line. So let's roll right into it. Number 4, 2's a team. 1, 2, start with F and. Rest. 2, switching notes, go. Rest. 2, 3, 4. Awesome. Number 5 is taking us down to the bottom line of the staff, and these are called E. Every good boy deserves fudge. I bet you've heard that many times from your general music teacher. So look at your fingering chart next to it. The E is going to be thumb and first finger closed on the tone holes. Thumb on an angle, first finger kind of straight into the clarinet. Here we go. We're going to play line number 5. 1, 2, play with me, ease. Rest, 2, 3, 4. Rest, 2, 3, 4. Now I got a question for you right now. When you're taking a breath in between playing, I've been lifting off because I'm talking back to you, but if I weren't talking, I would leave my teeth and my bottom lip in place. Remember, it's kind of stretched out. And I breathe through the sides of my mouth. Be careful. Think about it and ask yourself, am I not releasing the sides of my mouth? And am I trying to breathe through my nose? Which is not anywhere as efficient as if you breathe through the sides of your mouth. So I keep my contact right here. And I breathe out the sides. Okay, I keep this in place and I just let the corners relax and open. I draw my breath through my mouth, which gets me a lot of breath in very quickly. So I want you to think about that this week when you go to take a breath. Try not to breathe through your nose, but breathe through your mouth. Okay, so now we're going to go on to number 6. So this is going to use, our first notes are E, and they're helping you out with them. We've got the letter in the middle of them, ahead of the note. And then we're moving from E's to F, which is thumb, and then finally G, which is open. So let's do line 6, moving on up together. Thumb and first finger closed. 1, 2, play with me, breathe. Rest, rest, rest. Rest, rest, rest. Good job. Now you might have to stop and kind of back up on that because that one's kind of an active one compared to what we've been doing on this page. But if you're on this page and you're like, I got it, awesome. If you need to back up and do this again many times with me, go ahead and do it. But if you're like, I've got this, I'm with you so far, then we're going on to page 5 today. And so the first thing that we need to do to get the next note to sound correctly in 7, going on in 7, 8, and 9, is we're going to go down and we're going to be leaving our thumb and first finger down, and we will be adding our second finger for the note D that you see in number 7, the long haul. And then finally, in number 9, the note C, which is all 3. So I want you to hear what happens when I play G, F, E, D, C. You're going to hear something go a little wonky. All of a sudden, that last note does not sound low enough. It didn't sound like what I had sung to you. We need the rest of the clarinet to make the proper pitch. So this is the week. We're going to try to go to the full clarinet. And it's going to be totally normal if you really kind of feel this in your thumb. I don't want you to get discouraged because a clarinet does seem heavy at first. And I promise you that feeling will go away. Okay, I'm excited to show you this next thing. But first I'm going to show you this. In your keys, you're going to notice that there's a key that sticks out. This is called a bridge key. And when I pick up my other joint, so I have an upper joint, this has the really pretty silver keys on it, and I have a lower joint that's a little bit longer, and it also has a whole lot of pretty silver keys on it. There is a bridge that is on this side also. So when I go, you may need to use your cork grease on this joint here, if it's new, to get it together. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold up here, and I'm also going to hold a little lower down here. And I'm going to line up these two keys that lay over the top of each other. Now, they're very close right now. And so I'm going to slide my hand down and I'm just going to put my fingers on my keys that I was using to like play E and D. And you see that if I put my fingers down on my tone holes up here, it'll pop up and it gives me room to really safely put the two together. So I want you, when you put these two pieces together, I want you to pay attention and I want you to actually be looking at these keys so that you can see them. Now, when I go to put them together, I'm going to put a decent amount of pressure on my cork. So my cork is a little tight today, probably because it's cold and it's getting ready to snow outside. And I'm going to put the two pieces together so that the upper joint is bridge key is over the lower joint bridge key. And there's a good picture of this in your book if you need to double check it. But I'm going to give short little twists. Now, what you don't want to do is try to crank it all the way around. Because remember I told you these four here, we got to watch out for these guys that stick out. And if I crank it all the way around, this mechanism will actually catch into each other. These that stick out on this side and these that stick out on this side will collide. And as the word suggests, that's not going to be a good thing, right? So we want to make sure that these keys that stick out stay on this side, and these keys that stick out on this side. So it's going to make for some really short little twists. And remember the trick I showed you last week? You can use it this week too. It's like, oh, I'm having a little bit of trouble. My corks are still tight. They're new. You can grab in your barrel, which is your safe zone, and just with your knee, press down. And that'll help give you a little bit more oomph to get it together. People are always very nervous when they first do this, and it takes them a little while to get it all the way together. And that's okay. Taking your time and being careful is way better than having bent keys. So you will get quicker at it as you move along. And then finally, the last piece that we're going to put together is the bell. And the bell doesn't have to go on any specific position, but a bell just focuses your sound. I didn't change my voice. I didn't change the volume of my voice, but you can hear that the quality. So all instruments, think of a trumpet. We have these bells and they help kind of focus the sound and acts like a natural speaker sort of to our instrument. So I'm going to put this on in the same thing with just short little twists. But if I get close and I want to use my bell, if I press, I can just hear it and feel it go all the way together. So you have these things called tone rings or rings in general. And these are kind of like girdles for your instrument. They really are. Not every instrument has them in every position, but you probably do. If they ever swing and turn loose, don't worry about that. They're actually doing their job. Right now it's cold outside. So if your instrument gets really cold, there will be a little bit of shrinkage. Where they really are important for us is when it gets really warm outside in the summer and things expand in the heat. And it's sort of a girdle that keeps the wood and the resinite from going too far. If it goes too far, it'll crack. So in the winter time, it's not uncommon that sometimes these little rings here spin and occasionally might even come off and you just set them back in. They're not supposed to be glued on. They are supposed to spin, and they are some. They when they get loose, they're doing their job. So if that's happens to you, don't worry. Everything's okay. All right. So now we're going to go on to page 5 and number 7. And the next note that we have is D. And a good way to remember the D is if you notice, it's down under the staff. Down under the staff is a D. And so we're going to play this. If you look at your fingering chart, I'm going to close my thumb and I'm going to close my first tone hole and my second tone hole. So let's do number 7 together. Here we go. These are D's. Ready? Begin. Rest. 2, 3, 4. Rest. 2, 3, 4. This would be a good place to pause and kind of give yourself another round of that. Maybe back it up a little bit and do it again with me. Sometimes it'll sound like this. It's very muffled. And only if you can see, I did not get my finger squarely covering that ring. So instead of ta, I get ta, and it closes off the sound because it's not resonating all the way. So just a little bit of finger wiggle and you should hit the square on. You should be good to go. If you have a lot of trouble with that sound coming up, go walk in wherever you've got a mirror, to the bathroom, to your bedroom, wherever you've got a reflection, and take a look at your finger while you're playing. That's really helpful because you can see it right away that you're not centered over the ring. And it's an easy fix. Okay, we'll be back in a sec. Okay, hopefully you had a good time with the new note D. And so now we're going to play number 8, which is called 4x4. And this is going to start on our D, which is thumb 1, 2. Hopefully me talking to you in numbers makes good sense to you now. And we're going to play 4 D's, and then we're going to move to the note E, which is, it's moving up, and I'm also moving up one position with my fingers. And then we rest. And then if you notice, in the third measure, it's going to jump. It's going to skip a note, and it's going to go up to the G. And remember, G mom, no hands. So G is open. And then finally, it's going to finish on an F. So let's try playing that together. And we may have to do this a few times. You may need to stop the video for a second and do this several times. That's okay, because that's how you become a musician, is just by repetition. That's the secret. Here we go, number 8. So thumb 1, 2. 1, 2, play with me, breathe. Rest. Now jump to G, open. Rest, rest, rest. Now, you may notice that there's a weird little sign at the end of that line. There's two dots, thin line, thick line. You might be saying, what does that mean? Well, at the end of a piece of music, if there's a thin line followed by a thick line, it lets us know that we are finished with that exercise. Because as we go, music will become more than just one line of music. It'll be longer pieces of music, even a whole page of music by the end of the semester. So this particular sign has two dots in front of it. And what that's telling us is, think of the dots, you're going to do it two times. Two times. So it's a repeat sign, and I hope you've done this in general music with some of your things, activities. So we would go back to the beginning and play it a second time. So we're going to pretend that we just finished the end of line 8, and now here's our repeat of line 8. So here's our second time. 1, 2, ready? Start with D. Rest, rest, jump to G. three, four. Good. So normally we wouldn't pause. We would count our rests out. Our eyes would go back to the beginning of the line and we would just do it a whole second time. So now you're ready for the big one. This is, if any of the notes are going to give you trouble, it'll be this one. This one will be a stinker. And the main reason is because the finger won't seal. You've gotten used to the feeling of the rings and the metal rings, and you can kind of feel when you're centered now. But this one doesn't have a ring on it. It's not designed that way. So you've just got to hit the tone hole squarely. And I'm going to show you something. If my thumb is too far this way, I am not going, my fingers will be out of position. And hitting this and getting it covered is not going to be very, I'm not going to do a very good job of it. So you want to make sure that it's just the fleshy part of your thumb and not too far and not too far back. We're not trying to close it with our nail, but our fleshy part. So a little bit of my thumbnail is going to be hanging over. And as I come down, I'm not slopping my finger over the tone hole. I'm not using the edge of my finger, like I'm not arched up. So if you're a piano player, you know how your teacher wants you to play like you have a tennis ball underneath your hand with a nice, beautiful arch. We're going to play with flat knuckle instead of an arched knuckle. So I see that a lot of times in piano players, that their natural reach is like this. And I need to flatten them out a bit. So our C, if you look at your fingering chart, we're gonna close thumb, one, two, and three. So if this note squawks at you, just keep at it. I promise you, you will get it, but it's not uncommon for this note to be a stinker at first. So let's try our C. Number nine, all three top tone holes sealed. Wiggle your fingers a little bit so you can kind of feel that you've got that circle opening underneath you and covered. Here's line nine, C. One, two, play with me, go. Rest, two, three, four. Rest, two, three, four. Good, now, I didn't say anything to you about what do you do with the rest of this instrument? Like, where does my hand go now, Mrs. Holloway? You may have been still holding here. Okay. You may have been holding down here, down low. Okay. But now we're going to put our hand where it really belongs and where it's going to be forever after this. We're going to put our thumb, and not too far in, our thumb on this little thing that sticks up on the back. This is called your thumb rest. And I'm going to put my thumb here, my right thumb. So remember, your left hand is always on top. Oh, so please be careful that you haven't been trying to play like this. This is much harder to get tone holes sealed up. See how there's sort of an opening here to get your hand in there. So our left hand is on top. Our right hand is going to come under here and you're just going to close. Now, you may feel like, oh my goodness, I don't like the way this feels. It feels like it's going to roll out of my hand. But when you have your teeth and your top lip here, you should be in pretty good shape. It may take a couple weeks till you feel confident. Resist the urge to do this. See how I'm just trying to be safe. Resist the urge and try to put it on your thumb. Now, some of you guys afterwards, you're going to be like, oh, I really noticed that on my thumb. Like my thumb is tired. That'll go away. Again, I promise it'll go away. But it's normal in the beginning that you might kind of feel like a bit of concrete hands. And you might feel like you're doing this. Sometimes I see young players do this. They try to take the stiffness out of their hands. So you don't want to clutch, just a nice, easy thumb underneath and a curl of the hand. Trust me, you've got it. Okay, so we're going to try number 10. If you cannot get number 10 this week, don't worry about it. This is really a high goal for us this week. So here we go. We're going to start on C's. Four C's, and it moves to D. And then after the rest, it's going to jump to an open G, 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 thumb F, E, and we're going to rest it out. For today, we're not going to repeat. I know there's a repeat sign at the end of line 10, but we're not going to play it for today. Just we're going to try it one time through. And again, if you've got it, awesome. If you're like, this did not go well, Mrs. Holloway, don't panic. I just want to see where you're at, how close you could be to getting this. So if it's not perfect, it's okay. All right, so here we go. You ready? Let's try it. One, two, play with me, breathe. I am so excited to see how you do with this for next week. So your assignment is going to be playing these few that we just did and recording them and sending them to me so that I can hear how you're doing. But remember, repetition, repetition, repetition. Hopefully, you'll find that 7, 8, 9, 10 are really tricky. But maybe 1, 2, 3, 4 is pretty easy for you each week. And that's the normal flow of this. We want to try something new that seems really tricky, but we keep working on from where we started, and it gets easier and easier, and we keep moving through the process. So have an awesome week. Try to play every day. And I'm going to be back in a second to make sure that you're taking your instrument, now that we have all the pieces, that we're taking it apart correctly, and we know how to clean it or really dry it out properly. Have a great week.